That's right. You know what time it is, folks. Time for KP's video news, y'all. Yeah. Yeah. You know, hey, we moving right along. Moving right along. Here we are. We in a whole nother month here. Second day of March. And March Madness is getting ready to kick in. So we won't be getting none of this right here for a while. As far as you know, we won't be seeing any of this for a while. Oh, well, till they get together and get that contract going. Anyway, I'm going to continue doing this, doing my history thing here, doing my Black history, like I stated, you know, even though, you know, we had like Black History Month in February, I'm going to continue doing this Black history because it's there. It's there and it's a lot of it. I could do a story every day for to the end of the year. And I guarantee I would never do the same story twice. So I've been doing these individual. Now I'm gonna do the whole group. And for decades, female NASA employees dubbed human computers helped the United States excel in the space race, but yet their critical contributions remain largely unacknowledged, not only outside NASA, but within it. The movie Hidden Figures introduces three of these women, Mary Jackson, Katherine Johnson, and Dorothy Vaughan. While their stories are compelling, the work of their colleagues who still remain in history's shadows was also of great importance. Here are a few of the other Black women of NASA you need to know who served during the Hidden Figures era. Their stories are being told in the Hidden Human Computers, the Black Women of NASA, a book written by Sue Bradford Edwards and Dr. Duchess Harris, whose own grandmother was one of the Hidden Figures, and published by ABDO in December 2016. We spoke with Harris to learn more about the other Black Human Computers and their achievements. Miriam Mann. In 1943, Miriam Daniel Mann learned about a job opportunities at the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics. It was called NACA at the time, and this was NASA's predecessor. Mann, who had earned a chemistry degree with a minor in mathematics from Alabama's Talladega College, was perfect for the human computer position, which was among the most demanding jobs for women of her era. Mann, who was born in 1907, was hired by NACA, which is at the time was operating 24 hours a day. And so the arrangements made for a very different household in an era when the norm was for women to stay at home, said Mann's daughter. And yeah, she was out there doing the thing. Let's see. Man, you know, it wasn't just math and computing Mann performed. However, her daughter recalls her mother quiet acts of resistance against the segregation that existed inside NASA, including removing the colored sign from the table in the back of the cafeteria and accepting her white female boss's invitation to visit her apartment. Such an invitation, crossing lines of both professional rank and race, was quite unusual for the time. And though Mann would pass away 2 years before Neil Armstrong walked on the moon, she was aware that her work, both the computing and civil rights actions, made significant contributions to NASA advances between the 1940s and the 1960s. Katherine Pedrew, like Mann, had graduated from college with a chemistry degree and was hired by NACA in 1943. She would spend her entire career there, retiring in 1986. She had been praised by parents and raised by parents who had taught her she could be anything she wanted to be, and her belief in herself never wavered, even as she endured both gender and the racial discrimination in a job search before arriving at NASA. Pedrew wanted to join the research team of one of her college professors who studied quinine incited deafness in New Guinea, but was denied the opportunity because the team had no contingency plan for housing women separately from men. Anyway, she joined NACA as well. We had Christine Darden, and racial discrimination practice at NASA hadn't improved much by the time that Christine Darden applied for her position in the late 60s. Darden, who had held a master's degree in engineering, was qualified for an engineering position within the agency, nonetheless assigned the human-computer role, which represented a sub-professional category. NASA could take advantage of the knowledge conferred upon her through her degree, but wouldn't assign her a position or corresponding pay grade that was commensurate with it. Darden, whoever wasn't one of the crowd into conformity and fully cognizant that she was capable of holding a professional position within the agency, she confronted her supervisor and was transferred to an engineering job in 1973. In this role, she worked on the science of sonic booms, making specific advances on sonic boom minimization and writing more than 50 scholarly articles on the subject. Annie Easley, who joined NASA in 1955, would work at the agency for 34 years. She had the same self-awareness and confidence as Darden, as well as the same tenacity for ensuring her rights were respected. In the 60s, Easley wrote the computer code for the Centaur rocket stage, dubbed by NASA as America's workhorse in space. Centaur has been used in more than 220 launches. Easley's code was the basis for future codes that have been used in military, weather, and communication satellites. Wow, these are some amazing women. And so, you know, despite this accomplishment, Easley's encountered staggering discrimination. And all these women did all the things that they had to do for working for NACA, which is the predecessor of NASA, which came along later. And all these women worked. And if it wasn't for them, wow, this whole thing never would have got off the ground. Wow, amazing women. Okay, I'm going to go on to the next story. On to the next story right here. So, you know, let's say, you know, you got a person that has an issue with you and they decide to create a social media account using your name, but not an IP address associated with you. Let's say that person with the issue uses a fake account to make murderous and terrorist threats. How long would you guess it would take for the authorities and social media platform to figure out you're not responsible? An hour, 3 hours, a full day? And what if for nearly entirely of 11 days, you are a 13-year-old black girl locked in a juvenile detention center. So for the better of 2 weeks, you were an innocent child just in her teen years being separated from your family and in prison for something you didn't do, giving you a up close and personal look at the racist criminal system you've never asked for. And Nia Wims of Miramar, Florida, is suing the META, the company that owns Instagram, Renaissance Charter Schools at Pines, and the Pembroke Pines Police Department over an incident that took place last year where one of her classmates at the school impersonated her on Instagram and used the account to threaten to blow up the school. The impersonating student also made fake murder threats against herself as well as teacher at the school and that teacher's family. Nia reportedly denied sending the messages when the police came to her home to question her. So why did it take so long to prove an easily provable claim of innocence? Well, according to the police, it was the black family's fault. Following an extensive and thorough investigation, our department, the original student arrested in the 13-year-old female victim one was exonerated of these charges, the department said in a statement. At the time of our initial investigation, the family of the victim chose to exercise their rights and did not cooperate with their investigators. That's what they're supposed to do. Nia Williams, 13 years old, was held at a juvenile detention for 11 days after classmate impersonated her on Instagram. So right now the family has filed a lawsuit, and so the lawsuit alleges that the police failed to promptly investigate this easily discoverable information and that Instagram refused to promptly provide or cooperate with the investigating officers, with the result of Nia being placed in handcuffs in prison which in the lawsuit said shocks the conscience and beyond the bounds of decency. So you got a, come on now, man. You got a 13-year-old girl. What is she going to do? Where is she going? 13-year-old kid, where is she going? Could have left her at home. Could have left her at home and said, okay, well, you know, if anything, you're suspended from school until we find out what's going on. But no, they took the girl locked her up in jail. Locked up in jail for almost 2 weeks. And then, instead of giving an apology for making a mistake, they blamed the family, saying that if you wouldn't exercise your rights, listen to what I said. The cops stated that if the family didn't exercise their rights, she wouldn't have been arrested. Wow, that's crazy. That goes beyond stupidity. Okay, now let's go on to the next little bit of stupidity here. They had a police board votes to fire a cop who threatened a former recruit when she dumped him for intimidating police academy classmates. Yep. So, in other words, a jilted officer said, you thought you were going to throw me under the bus. I'm taking you with me. The jilted officer said in a text message, threatening also to report his ex-girlfriend's family to immigration officials. And the Chicago Police Board voted unanimously to fire an officer who menaced a former recruit after she broke up with him for threatening two of her classmates at the police academy. Livia Tomescu, a human resources officer whose job duties included conducting background checks on recruits, was found guilty of all but one of the 11 administrative charges lodged against him, according to a written ruling by the board. The allegations centered around Tomescu's belief and tumultuous relationship with Rafia Iqbal, which began in summer 2018 when she was at the police training academy. Iqbal has since become a sworn officer. Iqbal ended the relationship by October 3rd of that year, just 2 days after Tomescu threatened two of her classmates over an off-color joke that was made at her expense. According to the board, in the week after the breakup, the jilted cop then directed his ire toward Iqbal. You thought you were going to throw me under the bus. I'm taking you with me, he stated. And the board noted that Tomescu had previously grown very angry when one of Iqbal's academy classmates joked that she was another recruit's woman after she was named their homeroom secretary. He then made threatening calls to the recruit who had made the joke, and another classmate prompting them to report him to their homeroom instructor. Iqbal ended the relationship, but the harassment continued when he contacted her sister and asked for help repairing the relationship, the board wrote. Iqbal's sister was married to another recruit, and Tomescu used his background check information to contact the couple. Later that October, Tomescu was stripped of his police powers. Then in March 2019, an internal affairs investigation requested he be assigned to a program for police officials having issues affecting their competency. He was fined for time found unfit for duty and placed on medical duty, according to the board. And last April, Superintendent David Brown recommended Tomescu's firing. Tomescu then argued last October that Brown was barred from pursuing the charges against him because he had already been punished when he was sent to the program for officers leaving having competency issues, medical leave. The board denied Tomescu's motion, saying those weren't disciplinary actions. And they just said, well, you know, they went ahead on and got rid of him. And telling you, man, yep, on with the next one. So they have a alderman approved a $1.4 million settlement for the mother of a toddler that was killed during a high-speed police chase. $1.2 million payment of the two innocent men shot at by off-duty cops now facing felony charges. So this is another story from Chicago. A woman whose 13-month-old son was killed by a hit-and-run driver during a high-speed police chase in 2015 received $1.4 million settlement from the city in a lawsuit accusing police of failing to call off the pursuit when it posed a significant risk to pedestrians. Dillian Harris was sitting in a stroller as he and his mother waited at the bus stop near 63rd and Ellis. And then the 21-year-old Antoine Watkins jumped the curb while fleeing the police and ran over the toddler. Police has stated, started chasing Watkins after seeing him flee the scene of a shooting about 4 miles away near 77th and Kingston. So, wow, man, they went on a chase. Meanwhile, the Finance Committee also approved a $1.2 million settlement with Homer Correto and Carlos Ramirez after an off-duty cop shot at them in December 2020 and was later charged with felony aggravated battery in the shooting. Police have said that December 11, 2020, Officer Kevin Bunge was sitting on in a parked car in the 3300 block of West Irving Park Road when he reported hearing gunshots. He then walked up to Coretto and Ramirez, who were parked behind him, and originally said the men aimed guns at him first, prompting him to open fire. However, the only gun investigators found belonged to Bunge, and the video indicated the opposite chain of events from Bunge's story. After Bunge was charged with felony aggravated battery 3 months later, his attorneys changed the narrative slightly, claiming that he feared that Coretto and Ramirez were going to carjack him after the two previously failed carjackings in the recent prior weeks. They tried to throw a little twist in the game, but it didn't work. So Bunge faces felony charges and has been suspended. Telling you, man. So they approved that second $1 million settlement. That's $2 million settlement. So now going on to the next $1 million. A Russian businessman is offering $1 million to any military officer who apprehends Russian President Vladimir Putin, dead or alive, for committing war crimes in his invasion of the Ukraine. Alex Koryakin, an entrepreneur and former banker, posted the bounty on social media as Russia enters a full week of military action against a neighboring country. Western governments and companies have responded to the invasion by seeking economic punishment to Putin and Russia's ruling elite. The bounty offered by Koryakin, who is now based in the United States, placed an even more direct target on the Russian leader as backlash over the invasion continues to escalate. Wow. So, as an ethnic Russian and a Russian citizen, I see it as my moral duty to facilitate the disenfranchisation of Russia, Koryakin stated in a post. Putin has sought to justify his invasion of Ukraine by saying Russian forces would densify the country, an explanation that has been dismissed by Western powers. Wow. So now you got people with money that are over there that are sick and tired of this guy too. And they're ready to get rid of him. They are ready to get rid of this guy here. And we're gonna surround and put a contract out on it. Oh well. Oh well, oh well, oh well. What do they think of next? Well, I'll tell you what I'm gonna think of. I'm gonna think of what it is. I'm getting ready to go eat for lunch. And it's KP's Video News. And you know how I do.
KP's Video News.
KP's Video News, y'all.